Hello, good day to you. Welcome back to another chapter on this channel. We have made it to the last video, last chapter of this whole syllabus, and this topic will be on ecology. This topic will be pretty similar, pretty related to the subject of geography if you are taking that subject, how the environment affects an individual. So before we begin, we will go through some very basic vocabulary in order to help us better appreciate this topic. Number one, habitat, the place where an organism lives. It could be in the tree, in the leaf litter, in the water, so on and so forth. And a population will be the number of the group of the same species in the same habitat. For example, talking about the number of birds or fish in the area. And the next is the community, a variety of different populations interacting together with one another in the same habitat. Ecosystem will be the interaction between all the organisms and also the non-living environment. Okay, so first we'll investigate the several factors of the abiotic environment that possibly can affect living things within them. Abiotic simply means the non-living component. For example, light intensity affects the ability of plants to photosynthesize and grow and thrive and multiply, and also affects the ability of plants to provide oxygen into the environment. Also, with the flourishing of plant population, it will also affect the number of herbivores that it can support in the area. Next would be temperature. Of course, you have learned in earlier topics that temperature affects the enzymatic action on living systems. So basically all living things, plants and animals, will be affected by this. The availability of water as well. Most of living things will be affected by water. Oxygen required for respiration to unlock the energy within food substances. The pH of the environment as well, like soil and the water, as well as the salinity, the amount of salt. These will affect the pH action as well as the direction of water movement within cells. As covered in all the earlier chapters, like high levels of salt will lower the water potential and will affect the direction in which water will flow. The water will go to by osmosis. And coupling with abiotic environment, there will also be the biotic environment, which is the living things, plants and animals that are within the area. They are interdependent on each other. The producers, mainly the plants, the herbivores, the carnivores, how they interact with one another and how they affect each other if one of them is too little or too much. So these population sizes in the environment should remain relatively constant, achieving a biological balance or equilibrium. To better understand how different parties in the environment interact with one another, usually a series of pictures are used to illustrate them. For example, in a food chain, you can see over here, the plant is eaten by a herbivore, and the herbivore is eaten by a small carnivore, and the small carnivore is eaten by a large carnivore. So the arrows represent being eaten by. And each stage in the food chain will be known as a trophic level, which means the feeding position within the food chain. And a series of interlinked food chains will give you a food web. So this is a chain. This is an example of a food web. So this can be considered a chain, this as well, this as well, this as well, so on and so forth. Also, another diagram of interest will be the pyramid. Pyramid of numbers and pyramid of mass. So using the earlier example of the plant, the herbivore, carnivore, okay, this will look like it. There are many plants and then there are lesser herbivores, much lesser carnivores, and finally an even lesser tertiary consumer. Pyramid of mass. The numbers are constructed by the dry mass of the organism within the environment at any one time. Sometimes there are certain variations like this. So you can see there is one tree, many small bugs and lesser bigger bugs and even lesser tertiary consumers. Or in the case of parasites, parasites usually will be larger in number as compared to the food source. So there's lots of grass, one herbivore and many parasites. Also, for pyramids of biomass, they do not take into account the reproduction rate, productivity of the organisms. So sometimes the shape of the pyramid can vary in this case. And just for exposure, there's also such thing called the pyramid of energy. So as you can see, about 90% of the energy is lost when energy moves from one trophic level to the next. Most of it is lost through heat and respiration and movement. As such, short food chains are more efficient in energy transfer. So the energy from the sun passes through the producers all the way to the final trophic level quicker, sustains the most amount of energy. And with that, we will go into the next part of this video, talking about how energy moves through an ecosystem. So of course, first, the energy comes from the sun in the form of light and heat energy. Producers like plants and other photosynthetic organisms that are able to trap light to create food will do so using the chlorophyll within them to trap light energy to form chemical energy. Sounds very complicated. It simply means forming of bonds, taking the form of glucose, which is the common example that we have explored in earlier videos using carbon dioxide and water. So producers are a very important part of the ecosystem because they affect other organisms because they are the one trapping the energy from the sun and provide them to the other consumers with energy and oxygen. Okay, next we'll be talking about the consumers. There are several kinds of consumers: primary, secondary, and tertiary. So primary consumers, they are the herbivores. They feed on the producers, the plants. So these animals, these consumers that eat the plants will be the herbivores, and secondary ones will be the ones that feed on the primary consumers. Therefore, they are carnivores. Then tertiary consumers exist as well. They are the ones that feed on the secondary consumers. Usually they are the larger sized carnivores. And lastly, we have the decomposers like bacteria and fungi that feed on decaying organic materials, breaking down biological materials from dead organisms, breaking down waste materials like feces, excretory materials, and they pull apart all these atoms and return them to the environment. That's why it's called decompose, to break apart the carbon in organic matter in the form of carbon dioxide into the environment as well. So this will be how the carbon is cycled along the environment. Carbon cycles help to ensure continuous supply of carbon dioxide for plants. Carbon compounds carry this stored energy from organism to organism in the form of bonds with other atoms, like for example in a sugar compound or protein compound, and overall helps to maintain the correct concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Therefore, all players of the carbon cycle are important in the correct amount. So talking about carbon cycle, it is also important to understand what is a carbon sink. A large area that holds carbon or carbon compounds for an indefinite period. This stores more carbon that it is able to release. One such example will be the ocean. It is the largest carbon sink on the earth. So firstly, the carbon dioxide has a low but natural tendency to be able to dissolve in the water. Then photosynthetic organisms in the water will use this carbon for manufacturing of food substances. Another will be forests. As you already know, that carbon is integral to construct many, many biological compounds, and one tree can be really, really heavy, having a large mass of carbon-containing compounds. Therefore, forests are also another form of carbon sink. They are able to take in the carbon dioxide and build onto itself. Large amount of carbon compounds are stored in trees. With the first half of the chapter out of the way, we're going to how human activities impact the ecosystem. So due to agriculture and industry and economic practices, usage of environmental natural resources may result in deforestation, overfishing, and pollution. So forests are cleared for a large variety of reasons like these. And deforestation can have negative impacts on the environment like soil erosion, because the roots are no longer holding on to the soil and is no longer absorbing the water that enters the soil. So with the soil being exposed to rain, erosion can occur quickly. And soil erosion can also block water pathways and raise the water level, causing floods. Because of cleared forests, sunlight reaches the soil directly and water evaporates quickly, the land becomes barren and unable to support life, therefore causing the land to become desert-like, leading to desertification. Overall, causing climate change because forests, the trees, transpire and release water vapor into the atmosphere, forming clouds for rainfall. With less trees, there are less rainfall. The area becomes drier and warmer. Next, we go on to uncontrolled fishing practices. Sometimes fishing equipment can catch marine life indiscriminately, meaning the catches will be of target and non-target fish. Some are small and young, they do not have the chance to grow and reproduce, therefore causing the population to be endangered or even extinct. And lastly, pollution, addition of substances that make life undesirable or unfit. These substances are called pollutants. So pollutants like sewage, inorganic waste, and insecticides are the common pollutants that humans can introduce into the environment. So sewage, of course, can introduce disease causing bacteria if left untreated and left in the environment. Eutrophication can occur due to the excess phosphates and nitrates available. Algae and water plants can grow excessively. This prevents sunlight from reaching the submerged plants, and therefore the amount of oxygen that is produced in the water will be depleted, and fishes in the water body can suffocate and die. And how sewage treatment is done will be as follows. Students will need to know the role of microorganisms used in sewage treatment as an example of environmental biotech. So firstly, screens will filter large insoluble materials, and it goes on into the primary settlement tank, and large materials, the suspensions will settle as a sludge and they get removed. The remaining top liquid will be fed into an aeration tank where air is pumped into the water together with aerobic organisms, microorganisms. The microorganisms use the dissolved oxygen for aerobic respiration, breaking down and absorbing the organic pollutants. The treated water is then channeled into a final settlement tank. Microorganisms settle to the bottom as sludge, and the excess sludge will be sent to the anaerobic digester, and a small portion will be returned to the aeration tank for it to remove organic pollutants. The effluent of the final settlement tank contains treated water that will be released into rivers or further treated by reverse osmosis to produce clean water known as new water in Singapore. And lastly, in the anaerobic digester, anaerobic bacteria will further decompose the sludge, producing biogas to be used as a fuel. The remaining processed sludge will be used as fertilizer or burnt. So next, we go on to inorganic waste. They can be released into the environment by industries containing poisonous metals like these, and these are absorbed by the plants. The fish will consume the plants, the fish will be caught, and whoever consumes them will be poisoned. Lastly, we talk about insecticides. Sometimes they can be accumulated in the consumers that consume the plants or the water where insecticide can be found. And so the insecticide concentration in the consumer's body will increase. This is called bioaccumulation, and is also passed along food chains, increasing the concentration in each trophic level, known as bioamplification. Therefore, the consumers at the last trophic level will accumulate large amounts of insecticide, suffering from toxic effects. And lastly, with all these harmful practices on the environment that we have covered, we need to know the importance of conservation, which is necessary to protect and maintain the biodiversity on the earth. Here are some reasons for conservation, which is quite straightforward, so I won't cover too much into detail. And these are some measures that we can do. And that is all for today. Hope you enjoyed this video. Give it a like and subscribe. Share it with somebody that needs to see this. And I will see you in the next video. Bye.